हेलो गुंताशा।
हाय हाय सर, हाउ आर यू? एवरीथिंग
ओह आई एम गुड, हाउ आर यू?
आई एम गुड सर, एवरीथिंग इज गुड. ऑनलाइन टीचिंग हैज स्टार्टेड एंड वी आर ट्राइंग टू एडजस्ट टू द न्यू डायनामिक्स ऑफ इट इन व्हिच एवर बेस्ट पॉसिबल वे वी कैन.
ओके एंड दिस न्यू एरिया इज इमर्जिंग एंड वी आर ऑल इवॉल्विंग विद इट। वी आर लर्निंग एंड we are trying to adapt ourselves to the most critical times of human history, and so human has learned like this. We are sharing paper, the popular literature. We are here to disseminate this paper to our students to facilitate their learning. So first of all, I would like you to just tell us units that are there in this course.
Yes. So this is a paper on popular fiction, and like most of the things under LOCF, so this has undergone a transformation, the syllabus, slight transformation, and there have been small additions and also modifications. So basically the paper deals with a rich background to popular fiction. That's obviously the entry point about, you know, how we have to approach popular literature in 19th century, the relationship of popular literature to 19th century print culture, mass culture, theories of Marxism and Frankfurt School sort of seeping into how we look at popular literary texts and so on. There are some key terms with which we begin this course, and we begin familiarizing our students with these key terms, some of them being popular culture, mass culture, genre fiction, bestsellers, right, spy fiction, thrillers, and so on. And right, obviously right, the main division in the paper between four units is based on the genres. So you have science fiction, and then there is children's fiction. There is detective literature, one unit on detective literature, and there's graphic fiction, which has Bhimayana. So it's a very holistic kind of a coverage of different new and very upcoming genres that have given popular fiction a very strong credibility finally in discussions and English departments across the world.
Okay, so you see, we are here to basically create a structure. We are here to create an image of the syllabus. For example, we have the image of a tree, and image of a tree tells us about the fruit, about the seed, about the root, the leaves, and water, rainfall, and birds. So you see, one image can actually have lot of links and interlinks. So this syllabus of popular literature, like other syllabi of English literature courses, is made up of three pillars. So there are three pillars. One is the pillar of text, which is we consider to be the most important, in the sense that this is fiction, storytelling, characters, real, feeling, emotional area, where one connects to literature and art and human creativity. Another area is of background readings. Okay, one, this is another pillar. And one pillar is this of key terms like mass culture or popular culture. So we have an image here of a triangle, and this triangle is each pillar of which is equally important. So how would you elaborate this, the triangle, these pillars, and how they are interlinked?
Sir, I am so thankful that you put it like this, because I think LOCF syllabus, the newly modified syllabus, encourages us to look at the triangle as a whole. Because, you know, in the earlier syllabi experiences, we've often seen that there have been these isolated there can be risk of an isolated reading of texts without the context or without the background. But now there is a perfect blend and balance between how a text is generated, how a text stands as an autonomous entity, and what are the key areas that a text brings into focus, which makes popular culture, popular fiction, such a significant area of discussion.
See, something like, you see, the triangle is a structure. If we remove one pillar, then the two pillars,
it collapses.
Will fall. So this is important for all of us as teachers and students, that we see that structure in the syllabus. And that structure is a kind of soft or psychological building, which has a foundation and a different floors. So that kind of thing. Now, having created this image, let us go to one triangle, one pillar, and see in this pillar, what are the posters put on this pillar? For example, in textual area, in children literature, who are the writers? What are the texts?
So we have Lewis Carroll's Through the Looking Glass, which is the main text. And then there's Sukumar Ray's poem, which is about nonsense verse. So that is the main area of coverage that. And of course, the attempt is to not merely look at children's literature, but to also look at those serious discourses which you know, kind of challenge the apparent utopic harmony that people risk to see many times in the, in the apparent popular texts.
Let us first just look at the literature aspect, because this is something, you know, that is that feels, you know.
Right,
most of the articles which are based on research, they have a different kind of purpose. You know, that's more development at the cognitive level. But texts actually have an emotional bond with the human. So children literature, and then say detective fiction. And then science fiction.
Science fiction is there. We have a collection of short stories in that.
Then we have the graphic novel, Abhimayana. And that is also well illustrated in Gond art, tradition, tribal Gond art. So this one pillar is like the pillar that has been covered with so many cover pages, photographs, and it really creates a huge building, a huge, you know, picture for us. The second pillar, that of the background prose reading, which you were recently talking about, utopia and all. So would you like to just put some posters on this? There are five readings. Yes.
So in the background, sir, we have Darko Suvin, Felicity Hughes, and Christopher Pauling as the main writers. And again, I think the attempt has been to sort of look at writers talking about different genres and debates that have been related to popular fiction. So I, for one, have already begun with Christopher Pauling, and it's a very nice way to begin, because this very reading is titled Popular Fiction, Ideology, or Utopia. And that reading challenges the simplistic notions of popular fiction as either of the two, and encourages us to look a popular fictional text, as a consequence of cultural processes.
Right.
Which generates
these are critical readings.
These are
essays that will help students and teachers to develop critical ability.
And also an entry point into the course, good entry point into the course.
Entry point, and the critical ability will save them from the impact of literature, which can be anything. You know, we cannot take a literature or a film or a text, we cannot take it for granted. That it is
and through a set of preconceived notions either.
Yeah, there are so many things in one text, you know. So one has to develop the ability to read, not to read, but to appreciate. Otherwise, what you take home and how you see it may be very problematic for the learner. So these five essays in a way train students to develop critical insights, to see things in thematic areas, and to also see them historically, politically, sociologically, and also from the point of view of commerce, trade, nations,
yeah,
and discourse, narrative. So not reading or compromising with the one reading of in this section will actually be taxing to the development of cognitive powers of appreciation.
Absolutely.
Yeah. We have those five. You have start. You have talked about one little bit, and others. One is typology of detective fiction. Another is appearance. You know how visual appearance can be deceptive, how it can be political, how it can be politics, how it can be, you know, so there are issues involved, you know, in the world that we can talk about. Would you refer one or two more texts which are here?
I'm yet to share them with the class. So in the background, we have Felicity Hughes. That's a discussion again on children's literature. And there's Darko Suvin, who talks about teaching science fiction.
Yeah. So the point is that texts are entertainment. They inform us about plots. They inform us about characters. They inform us about environment, country, culture, and historical developments that are taking place. We know them through stories. And these background readings, they give us new eyes, new lenses to see how we read them. You see, ultimately, you know, the purpose of literature is not to make some, to get the answer from somebody, how one feels in literature, rather what one makes of it. So do you think that the background reading will help students in making their own kind of meaning out of the text they read?
Absolutely, sir, because they make student empowered. You know, the moment student learns the context, the sociological discourse, the political aspect, the cultural aspect, you know, it makes them more empowered to look at a text not as an isolated entity, but as something that's a consequence of so many complex social and cultural processes, which is, I think, very, very, for us as teachers and facilitators, it's a very...
So it means that, say, popular literature here, a murderer, for example, the word murder, detection, crime, and then say Bhimaina, we have caste oppression, dehumanization, even of Ambedkar.
Yes.
And then in other texts, that children literature or science fiction. Okay, so you see, all of these stories are not ideal. And you see, meant for consumption, as if they have been tailored to consume. So the task of facilitators is definitely to enable students how to see that murder in the context of the society, industrialization, rising rate of crime, or say greed, or you know, people want to become wealthy overnight, or you see technological development. So idea is that the student learns, you know, the moral lessons, and also develops the power how to heal these wounds, these you know, injuries, these murders, and to think creatively about it. Similarly about children literature. So how would children literature affect them? I mean, just as a general statement. Yeah.
Yeah, so sir, you know, I want to give a small example of a paper that I taught in 2019. When we earlier used to teach classical and Greek literature, students came up with a blank face. But now when we start with Plato, Aristotle, and we do the Bible, and then we start Greek literature with them, sir, they are so relatively better informed and so better, so, you know, they're so much more receptive to what you are telling them, because they become interested in the literary value of a text from a different vantage point.
Right.
So in a similar way, I think in this paper also, we have been given such empowering points of entry, which will not, you know, which will not reduce this paper to any simplistic construct in that.
Simplistic or sometimes one can start enjoying murder also. So
absolutely. And you know, for children's literature, yeah.
You can't enjoy tragedy. You can't enjoy, you know, we have to actually seriously think why these tragedies happen and why should they not happen and how there can be a better world and that's why there are three pillars. You know, if we have just one pillar and let the student or teachers just imagine at their own about the text, there would not be that kind of outcome. Carry on.
I just wanted to say, sir, that for something like children's literature, a very good entry point in a structure like this, a triangular structure as you put forth, could be that, you know, you have the annotated editions of Alice in Wonderland, you know, which tries to create a utopia out of a text in popular fiction. And, well, you have this edition that we are going to do, which doesn't blind you.
Right.
To the debates and the fissures and the issues, you know, that need to be put forth even before adults. So I think that in itself would be a very, very fascinating entry point into something like children's literature.
Right. Yes, true. You see, human evolution is in four dimensions. Say one is the genetic, which means that we are a body where our parents are inside our body, our ancestors are inside our body, our environment, water, fruit, all things are inside. So body is a microcosm. Second area is epigenetics, which is the outside the body. You have the society, you have the government, you have all kinds of those things, including the environment, oxygen level and everything, how it actually interacts with the body. Third area is the behavior. That is how the behavior and the body and environment interact. And the last and fourth is very important, is the culture, language, you see, art, history. And how does that help it? Actually, human imagination can bridge the gap, can recreate it, can balance the things. If there are two things which are of painful experiences, human imagination can fill it with some very interesting Alice in Wonderland. Okay, and that can really, you know, create a wonderful experience. So our, you know, subject is of that kind, which is a part of human evolution. Yes, it was a very interesting example that you gave. And lastly, the fifth pillar, the third pillar is of the key terms. Would you like to begin about that?
Yes, sir. So I think the key terms give us an opportunity to sort of take the students and learners into the progress of civilization and human mind. For example, the rise of the bourgeois class and the reading public in the mid-18th century. And then, you know, finally literature moving from the elites to the masses, which in itself is fundamentally the most beautiful thing about the 19th century. And how something like a discourse in popular fiction is a consequence of that. So, that kind of an entry point makes a student aware of the fact that from the elite, literature comes to the masses, and whether it is magazine fiction or the newspaper or the novella or the short story, finally, it is a literature written for the masses. So even if there is a commercial angle to it, you know, there is an inevitable transformation brought to language and cultural understanding of it,
which is
itself very,
So you mean that these terms like mass culture or popular culture reading public or like that.
Bestsellers, paperbacks, yes.
Yes, yes. So these terms, we read them in newspapers. We also watch people speaking out on media, television, etc. But now we have a deeper understanding of them. So students will actually not just consume mass culture as a term in a dictionarial sense, but will also go into the encyclopedia of say literature, popular culture or cultural studies, and will locate maybe 3, 4, 5 pages material on mass culture. And even the word culture, very complicated word in dictionary, okay, so that will perhaps tell a number of things, right from say law and farming and agriculture to cultivating, and how industrialization and later part started demanding the culture of mind. Okay, so I don't know when people go and colonize, why, in what manner they have to culture their minds, okay,
yes,
or deculture their minds. So this these terms actually give deeper understanding, and so once we have, you know, these three pillars in order, so in a way we have put a building that has a firm foundation, and pillars are based on certain foundation, and students and teachers can then climb up, walk, go down, see, and things will be stable, and they can really discuss that, and finally they all can decide what will be the outcome and what they can take home. And I would like you to have last word in this conversation.
Sir, the last word is, thank you so much for coming up with this idea and putting together this video. It just makes learning so much fun for us also, and I'm sure for the students also. When they'll see it, they'll gain so much from it, that possibly lectures every time are not able to deliver due to many limitations of their own kind. So thank you so much for being so animated about all this.
That's right. Thank you, and take care. And yes, give my love to your baby.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you.
And stay safe. Bye.